It's about 12 o'clock on Friday. Fabulous Friday. Hi, guys. How's everybody? Lots of you hopping on right now. How's your Friday going? It's a beautiful sunny day again here in Southern California, but I do hear that we're going to get rain next week. So for all of you on the East Coast and maybe in the South, it's getting rain. We're going to get that next week too. But today is beautiful. It's Friday and it's beautiful. Hey, Jamie. Hey, Sue. Hey, guys. Hey, Sue. How are those? How are your plants coming? Your tomatoes? I thought about that the other day. Tell John that we're missing all of our citrus and all of our tomatoes, and we're thinking of you. This is the time to have a garden. And the good ones have the best garden of anybody I know. So, Sue, now the word is out, but I thought of you with all your citrus and all the stuff that you guys bless us with. Hi, everybody. Rachel, hello, my love. Naomi. Jamie's going absolutely. Hey, Monica. So, I know I was just talking to my daughter, Jen, and she and her husband are putting in a garden in their backyard. And before they moved here, when they were in Denver, they had a beautiful garden. So it's not just because we're in a survival mentality, yet that's not a bad idea. But they are putting in a garden and getting their seeds and everything right now. So it's kind of the world we live in. And if it's hard to get out and get fresh produce, it's not a bad idea to start thinking about maybe planting some citrus trees or putting in a garden. And our world is changing and we have to start thinking a little proactively, right? Hey, Karen. Hey, Carla Ann. Good to see you guys. Hello, Karen. Well, guys, how's everybody doing? I mentioned it's Friday. It's fabulous. I'm dressed down a little bit. I got my Speak My Story shirt on. The office is closed today, so it's just me up here at the prayer wall. And I don't know. How about you guys? I've just been doing a lot of thinking the last few days. I want to share something very sweet with you though right now. I got up this morning and I just thought, God, I miss my girlfriends. I miss being a community. I just miss, even though we get to be together at noon and I love this and I'm still coming to work, so I see our staff, but I was missing just some girlfriend time. And I got out and I had my headphones on and I'm running down the street. And as I come around the corner, I ran into Renee Tripp from our church here and a friend of hers. And it was so neat. We did a 6 foot community, 6 foot distant prayer time. We stopped right in the street and we talked and we just had time to pray together. And I thought, God is so good, because I just said how I was missing having community. And I want you to begin to look for the things that God does for you. He does hear our cry. He knows our heart, you guys. When we cry out to him, so often we just don't see. I could have run right by those ladies and not stopped. But I took a moment and realized this was the very thing I asked you for, God, and you gave it to me. And I think what's happening in this time of quarantine and this time of change in our world is that we are beginning to look. We're beginning to see how God is listening. He is answering. He does communicate with us. And it's so important. And even to journal those things down. I want to remind you that we're doing the Story Club Saturdays. And I've given you that journal to start writing some things down because you don't want to forget this season. It will come and it will go. Things will look different. We have a new normal for sure. But don't forget how God walked with you through this time, because I guarantee you it's going to be easy when this is all done and blown away to get back into that mindset of, I can do this on my own. But if you start to create a relationship where every day you're seeing how God answers your prayer, every day he's walking with you. Karen, you sent me that beautiful image of the, it was an eagle. I think I posted it. I don't know if you guys saw it. An eagle feeding its young. And then when you flipped it over, it was actually a picture of Jesus. And just these images that we see that he is speaking to us. And there's a lot of fun things out there. For you to beginning to look at everybody's stories right now that they're sharing. So make sure you're seeing what God's doing. Hey, I want to start with something kind of fun. So I was just in the bathroom washing my hands, and I thought, isn't it crazy how we can't touch our face? We're not supposed to touch our face. But do you realize that from our birth, we are taught to touch our face? Now, isn't this true? You have a little child, and the first thing you say to them is, where's your nose? And they touch their nose. Where's your eyes? And they touch their eyes. Where's your mouth? Touch their mouth. Where's your ears? And we condition babies. We are conditioned from our birth to touch our face. So the fact that 1,000 times a day we're touching our face is because we learned to touch our face from our childhood. Isn't that so true? And it made me think about it. What are the things that I learned as a child that I can put into practice today? That's what really got me thinking about this. There were a lot of things that my mother and my father and educators and teachers taught me, and I thought, God, am I listening and am I hearing? So this morning when I was praying, one of the things that I remembered was my mom used to always sing this song to me out of Ephesians 6. And it was talking about putting on the armor of God. And she would teach us how to put on the helmet of salvation, and pick up the sword of the Spirit, the breastplate of righteousness, you know, shod your shoes with the preparation of the gospel. And I was singing this song this morning, and I thought, I learned at a young age about spiritual warfare. Now stay, this is so good. Stay with me. Listen, you need this. We learn about spiritual warfare. We know the scripture in Ephesians 6. We know the passage. We're going to read it together here in 2 Corinthians 10. But guys, now we're living it. It is so applicable right now. It makes so much sense right now. So I want to take a few moments in just the sweetness of our time together before we go to prayer. And I want to walk you through the weapons of our warfare. And the reason I thought about this, I don't know if you guys have noticed, but there's a lot of stuff on social media right now about owning guns and do you have guns and do you have weapons and are you protected? And there's mimes and jokes and everything out there, and the gun stores or people are lined up for ammunition and people are asking us, should I buy a gun? And although we should be protected, and that's your right in whatever way you want to be protected, I want you to know that the weapons of your warfare are not carnal. And though we want to physically be protected, we have to understand what the Word of God says. So I'm going to give you some scriptures. We're going to walk through them slowly and carefully in our few moments together and then pray them over ourselves. And then I'm going to ask you to go back and really meditate on these two passages and begin to think about where your safety comes from, where your protection comes from. You're protected by the blood of the Lamb. You are protected by Jesus Christ himself. We are under the protection of God. And let's talk about that a little bit. So in 2 Corinthians, you might want to write this verse down in 10, 4 through 6 is actually the whole passage, but I want to read actually verse 4. It says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. That means they're not of this world. The weapons of our warfare. So we're in a war right now. Make no mistake about it. We're in a war of our mind. We're in a war right now with what's going on in the world, with our economy and with just the atmosphere. We're in a world with the atmosphere, the environment, all of this, guys. We're in a war, but our weapon is not carnal. He goes on, he says, but it is mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. Now, guys, what happens in this time, and I know it to be true, I mentioned it yesterday, it's so easy to get a little discouraged, depressed, blue, sad, frustrated, angry. And you have to understand that these are spiritual strongholds that if you don't deal with these, listen, if you don't deal with these, they're going to take you captive. Today when I went out for my walk, I thought I need to just jog a little. And I'm not a real runner anymore because a lot of you guys know I've had hip replacements, so I've got to be real careful. But something happened, like I just started running. And I started running. I'm running up the hill. I ran what I could, and I stopped. But what happened was the adrenaline kicked in. The adrenaline kicked in. And I had the song Stronger going. I'm singing with Matt Gilman. I'm singing Stronger, and I'm running, and the adrenaline. And all of a sudden, the endorphins started kicking in. And I started skipping, and I started singing. And I'm skipping up the street, and I'm singing. And all of a sudden, my mindset shifted from being blue or sad or feeling confined to singing about being stronger, that I'm stronger, that there's nothing that the enemy can do to me. And do you see how a mind shift? I broke down that stronghold over me of discouragement, despair, feeling blue, sad, whatever that feeling and emotion. We have to deal with these emotions and these feelings because they become strongholds in our life, and we start taking it out on a husband or a child or even ourself. So you have to be aware of them. Now listen to this. This is our weapon. Our weapon is knowing, I'm going to give them to you in a minute, how to see these strongholds. So if you have a propensity toward depression or discouragement or anger or jealousy, those are already on the surface of who you are. So they're just going to come out. They're not down deep. They're just going to come out. And so you have to realize if you are responding or reacting in negative ways, those are strongholds in your life that you have to break down. And I want to teach you how to do that today through a passage in Ephesians. So in Ephesians 6, and I do want to read it from the Word of God other than just telling you, because I think there's power in reading the Word of God. So if you have your Bibles or your Bible app, you can actually look at this with me. But in verse 10, listen, finally, and I feel like we're in the finally. You know, we've been in this, 3 weeks now? Gosh, it's only been 3 weeks. How many of you feel like it's been like 2 months that we've been quarantined, right? And Paul says, listen, guys, finally, listen to me. Finally, that means it's important. I wouldn't keep going if I didn't have something important to say. So it's very important. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. If that's all that you underline, that's enough. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. If you've not downloaded the song Stronger, do that and just sing it over you and over you with Matt Gilman, Influence Music. I believe it's on our app, but you can get it on any of the, you know, Spotify, Pandora, any of those. Sing that. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. It's his mighty power that's going to get us through this. Put on the full armor of God. And some of us are running around half naked. Yeah, some of you don't have the full armor on. And I say that because there was just a ring on my phone a few hours ago that said that there is a naked bandit running around in our neighborhood stealing packages. Yeah, you're hearting me too. You got that one too on your alarm, on your ring? So there's this naked bandit out there taking these packages. Yeah, they don't have on the full armor of God. Yeah, we don't want to be running around exposed, right? It's not a pretty picture. Believe me. It's not a pretty picture to be running around naked. Now, you'll never forget this analogy. I know it. Put on the full armor of God. Be clothed in the armor of God. And I want to walk you through what these six pieces of armor on are. So he says, and here's what's interesting. Put on the full armor of God so that you can, and it says, take your stand against the devil's schemes. Underline and circle that word take. Do you realize you have to take it? You have to take territories. If you don't take authority, the enemy will have authority over you. It's very easy. Circle that. He says, take your stand against the devil's schemes. You can do that. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, and against the powers of this dark world. There are specific authorities and powers of this world. There is a world above us, a supernatural world, a heavenly world where principalities and powers are fighting. We have angels that protect us, but there's demonic spirits that try to war against us. So I believe that we are constantly being protected by angelic beings. We know that 2/3 of the angels remain in glory with God. They are to protect us. The Bible tells us that we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. The Bible tells us that we have angelic beings and angels that protect us. I believe that. But there also are 1/3 of the angels that fell and went with Satan. And they are demons today. And they are here to destroy you, defeat you. All they have to do is put one little thought in your mind and you do the rest. Do you realize that a demon doesn't have to do a lot to trip you up? He can put a thought of discouragement in you, and then you feed it with your flesh, and they're off to somebody else. That's the power that demons have over. So if you don't know how to fight them, so when the thought comes, jealousy, anger, bitterness, fear, whatever it is, you immediately say in Jesus' name, no, you will not win. You will not win, and you take authority, just what it says. It's Scripture says it, that these are the powers, the authorities of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. So there's a war going on, and you have to have your eyes and your ears receptive to the power of Almighty God, not to the enemy and his forces, right? So let's go on. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day comes, hello, this took us, just like the Bible says, like a thief in the night. Now, is Christ getting ready to come back? Is this the end? No, I don't believe so. But it did happen like a thief in the night. We were not prepared. I was telling Phil this morning, I think one reason I'm struggling is I'm not used to being so confined and having so many of my pleasures taken away. Like, I want to run get my nails done. Well, that ain't happening. Look at that. I need to get my hair done. I want to run to TJ Maxx. I'm going to run buy something special for dinner tonight. Oh, let's go to a movie tonight. Oh, babe, let's go out to eat tonight. All of my pleasures have been taken away from me, but those are carnal pleasures. Those are things that I was doing with my life, eating and drinking and enjoying my life. And those aren't bad things. But I had gotten so familiar with that lifestyle that when everything was taken like a thief in the night, and within moments we were quarantined to our homes, most of us don't know how to process this. Most of us are saying, what do I do with myself? Do you understand that? And that's what's happening. Just like he says, that's how quickly it comes, that you might be able to stand your ground, right? Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And that's where we are right now, guys. I believe that God is shaping the church. I believe he's preparing the church. I believe that we are, it's almost like we are in, we're in this war, but I have this feeling, I get this picture of being like in boot camp. Okay, listen to me for a moment. I was just in Peru a few weeks ago. Remember, I was in Peru, and we were able to go speak to the military there, and it was a beautiful experience. And as we made our way in, all of the new soldiers were just coming in, and they were out all working, and they were in boot camp. And they're marching, and they're doing their calisthenics, and they're learning all of their moves, and because they were in boot camp, because they were getting ready, they were getting prepared for the war. And I feel we're in boot camp. That God is preparing us. Do you remember, if you've ever been through calisthenics or anything, remember how hard that is? Your body fights it. But we are in boot camp right now because God's preparing his church. He's preparing his church to be prepared, not only in these last days, but with the message of Jesus Christ. It's exactly what Ephesians is telling us. It's coming alive. It's applicable and relevant to us right now. And then he goes on. I love this. Let's talk about this. Verse 14. Let's go back to 13. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so when the day comes, you may be able to stand against the evil one. And then what he says, stand firm. Now, I'm going to give you the six pieces of your warfare that you need, the six pieces of your weaponry that you need to put on, right? So here's what he says, stand firm with the belt of truth. So guys, you got to put on the belt of truth. That means you got to know truth. Now, if you're like me, I'm scrolling through all kinds of news feeds, and they're not even lining up with one another. That's not truth. The word of God is your truth. So you've got to put on truth. That's something you put on. You don't just walk in truth. You've got to pick up truth. You've got to know truth. So you've got to put on the belt of truth. And then he goes on and he says, we're on your waist, right? And then the breastplate of righteousness. First of all, listen, this breastplate, the thing, and it covers my heart. It covers my soul. It covers me here. It's this breastplate of righteousness. I have to know that I am righteous in Jesus Christ. That means I'm in right standing with him. I am not righteous. The Bible says my righteousness is but filthy rags. There's no good thing in me. But when Jesus saved me, he gave me his righteousness, and I became righteous in him. So when I put on this breastplate, he sees me in my righteousness. And some of you, listen, that's where the battle is in your mind. I'm not good, I'm evil, I'm doing bad, I'm this or that. No, you are righteous in Christ Jesus. You are his child, and you are covered from the arrows of the enemy that's coming. The arrows are coming. He's trying to get you with these arrows, right? But you have on that breastplate of righteousness that's protecting you. Don't ever forget to put on the breastplate of righteousness. And then he goes on. We've got the buckle and we've got the breastplate. And then he goes on and he says, listen, be sure that you put on the shoes, right? Fit your feet with the gospel of peace. Oh, is this a good one? Every day I put my sneakers on before I go for my run, I go for my walk. I need to also be putting on the shoes of peace. Put on the shoes of peace. So that means it's peace should be taking you everywhere. That's shalom. Shalom. Every day, put on these six pieces and think about it spiritually. So as I'm putting on my shoes, I'm saying, God, I'm going to walk in peace today. Everywhere I go, everywhere my foot steps, I'm going to walk in peace. I'm going to be a peacemaker. I'm going to think about peace. I'm going to bring peace. I'm going to walk in peace. So he says, make sure that you put on the gospel shoes of peace. And then he goes on and he says, in addition to this, take up the shield of faith with which you extinguish, the flames of the evil one. So that's what he said. You got that breastplate on, and then you pick up that shield, which is the word of God. And every time the enemy comes with an arrow, you just hold that word of God and you say, thus saith the word of God. You don't have to fight the enemy. Jesus fought the enemy for you. All you have to do is hold up that word of God, hold up that shield of faith. See, that's your faith. And so my question is to you right now, do you have faith? And I understand we live in a day that if you're like me, my faith is kind of like this, not my faith in Christ, not my faith in my salvation, but my faith, are we going to get through this? When are we going to get through this? Is it 2 weeks? Is it a month? Is it 2 months? But you have to understand that your faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. He will walk with you. He will talk with you. He will lead you. He will guide you. He will protect you. So when you hold up that shield of faith, you are saying to the enemy, no weapon formed against me will prosper. What you meant for evil, God will use for good. Do you understand how we are in a war? And you have to understand what your weapons are. Understand what your weapons are. So you're going to pick up that shield of faith. And then he goes on and he says, take the helmet of salvation. And you guys, when you put on that helmet, it is your salvation. If you don't put on the helmet, and a lot of us, you know, we don't want to mess up our hair. You look at my hair, looking pretty good today, right? I don't want a helmet head, but you're forgetting the reason we put on the helmet. What is the helmet? It's your salvation. Do you know that you are saved and sealed in the blood of the Lamb? And when I put on that helmet, no weapon will get me, no weapon formed against me, no weapon for me, no weapon that the demons bring me, no weapon demonic angels try to bring to me. No weapon formed against me because I have on this helmet that's protecting my mind. And guys, sometimes we haven't put on the helmet because our mind's running everywhere but toward God. Our mind is running toward fear and discouragement. Guys, just take a moment and put that helmet on right now. Let that helmet protect your head. Let that helmet protect your mind. And then he ends up and he says, the helmet of our salvation, which is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And ends with this in verse 18, and pray. And that's what we're doing. And then pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. Listen, with this in mind. Listen, so good. Listen, be alert and always keep on praying for all of God's people. So guys, you have to have these weapons. You've got to have the warfare to fight the enemy so we can pray on behalf of others. So what I want to do today, remember, if you've just joined me, I started how my mother used to always sing the Ephesians 6 song around our house. And she would teach us how to, there's four things that you put on and there's two things you pick up. She'd say, there's four things you put on and there's two things you pick up. And the things that we put on are the belt. The things that we put on are the breastplate. The things we put on are the helmet. And the things that we put on are the shoes. The things we pick up is the shield and the sword. And if you can learn that you are to equip yourself, put them on, four things you put on and two things you pick up, and learn to stand against the wiles of the enemy, the ploys, the deceit, the lies. Remember, he said he would not leave us as orphans. Jesus said, I will not leave you as orphans, but I will send the Holy Spirit who will guide you, who will protect you, and who will comfort you. So today as we pray, my first question to you is, do you know what the weapons of your warfare are? Have you put four on and picked two up? Have you meditated on the power that you have over the enemy? And are you fighting the right fight? Don't fight a carnal fight. Don't fight against your husband. Don't fight against your children. Don't even fight against the people at Target or Vons or wherever you're shopping. Don't fight the world. Fight the enemy. You know what I love to say? Know who your enemy is and who your enemy is not. Your enemy is the enemy. And fight him. So I want us to go to prayer today. And I want us to begin to pray right now over these things. Father God, right now, as everyone is that's on and we're praying together, we're going to start with ourselves. And we're going to start by putting on the weapons of our warfare. The only way to protect ourselves against the enemy is to understand the weapons that you gave us. You told us that there would be a war. You told us that we were in this military. We are your ambassadors, you tell us. You tell us that we are your children. You tell us that there is a spiritual war. And I believe that we are in a boot camp. and we have to learn how to fight the real enemy. So Father, right now, I just want to walk through those pieces in Jesus' name. Father God, I want to put on the helmet of my salvation. I want to pray in Jesus' name that you would take my mind. Everybody, just pray it right now. Take my mind. God, any thought I have against anyone, any anger, any jealousy, any suspicion, any issues, God, I release that. I do not let the enemy have any strongholds in my life. I forgive them. I love them. I bless them. Anybody right now that you're angry with, just it will make the enemy so mad if you would bless them right now. Call their name out right now. Whoever you are angry at right now, or hurt or jealous or whatever, pray right now a blessing over them. I pray over in Jesus' name, bless them, protect them, love them. Because what happens now, the enemy can't win the war of your mind. We put on right now the helmet of our salvation. We thank you for our salvation in Jesus' name. Father, I put on the breastplate of my righteousness, and I know that I am righteous because I'm your daughter. You know me by name. You love me. When I invited you into my heart, you saved me, and you gave me your righteousness. So this breastplate right now that's on where the enemy cannot attack me, because I am your child, I am your daughter, and you're protecting me, I thank you for that breastplate in Jesus' name. And oh, I just put on those sneakers right now, God. I put those shoes on, the shoes of peace. You tell me to walk in peace, not only toward others, but toward myself. Peace that you're protecting me. Peace that you love me. Peace that you'll get me through this. And God, I want to sow peace in my family. I want to sow peace in the world. And so, Father, right now, I want to walk in peace with those shoes in Jesus' name. And God, I put on that belt of truth in Jesus' name right now. I'm putting that belt on. I'm putting that belt on right now. And that belt, Father, is just secure right here around my waist. And it's a belt of truth. I want to speak truth. I don't want to quote statistics that aren't right. I don't want to listen to some media feed that says something that's not true. I don't want truth. I don't want to repeat something that's not truth. You are truth. You tell me your word is truth. So I put that belt on around me. The truth is, you said you love me and you will not forsake me. You told me that you would walk with me and guide me and lead me. That's truth. And so I put that belt on right now. And so, Father, I also pick up the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And in Jesus' name, I love the word of God. Thank you for speaking and giving me a written word that I can read. You literally, it's your life. It's your heart. It's your instruction for me. It's, you said that it's living and it's active. So thank you for the word of God. And I hold on to that sword, which is the word of God. And Father, I just thank you. I pick up that shield. You tell me with that shield, I can extinguish all the fiery darts of the evil one. So as those darts come at me in my mind, in my home, in my family, in my emotions, I just take that shield and I put those out right now. I will not let them penetrate me. I won't let them penetrate me. Father, I see all this in the supernatural realm. You told me that the weapons of my warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty for the destruction of strongholds. So in Jesus' name, as we're praying, our biggest prayer right now is that we would understand the weapons that we have. Teach us as your children to use the weapons of our warfare. Teach us how to pray for others. You end this passage in Ephesians 6 by saying that we would be equipped so that we could pray for others. So Father, now that we have on the armor, now that we've picked up the sword of the Spirit and the shield, Father, we pray for the world. We pray for the world. God, my mind right now just goes to the fact that here right now in Florida, these ships are coming in that have been at sea for 30 days, Father. And I'm sure, Father, that they've been in fear and in bondage, and now they're being united with their families. And we pray for those that have this coronavirus on these ships. In Jesus' name, we don't even know them, but we pray for them. That's what we do as the church. We pray for people we don't even know, because these are your children. Father, you love them, so protect them and heal them in Jesus' name. We continue to pray for all of these cities. Father, where's this influx of this coronavirus? Give them wisdom and insight and revelation. We pray against this demonic virus. We pray against this coronavirus in Jesus' name. We say it has no authority. It is demonic. It makes no earthly sense. If you look at it with spiritual eyes, you see how the enemy tried to come and steal and kill and destroy. So, Father, we speak against death and we speak life. over our homes, our family. The church is rising up. The church is praying. The church is speaking. We are ready. We are your soldiers. So Father, teach us and prepare us, because Father, when this passes, we want to be stronger than ever. We don't ever want to go back to where we were. We want to be a mighty force. We want to be a mighty army. We are in the Lord's army. We are your children. So teach us. Our time is limited. You tell us to number our days. You teach us, God, that our life is but a vapor that appears for a little while and vanishes away. May we never get back into that world of entitlement and just so much self-pleasure that we forget the purpose is being here for you. Wake us up and revive your church in Jesus' name. So, Father, thank you that you instructed us with these passages in Corinthians and Ephesians to teach us how to do warfare. Protect us. Protect us from evil. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Now, as we begin to just pray for one another, Father, you may want to just speak to someone. I was praying with Renee Tripp earlier today, and she prayed a sweet prayer, and she said, God, would you just bring people to our mind that we need to reach out to today? Someone that we haven't thought of for years, possibly. And so I want to join in that prayer right now. And everyone that's on Facebook Live and Instagram Live right now, if Holy Spirit lays someone on your heart, in your mind, would you just begin to pray over them right now? Maybe someone from your childhood, maybe a relative, maybe a neighbor. You see, Holy Spirit prompts us. This is how we learn to be prompted by Holy Spirit. So Father, I just want to pray over people right now. Father, you just brought to my mind my good friend, Janie Krager. Father, you just had a birthday yesterday. Love you, Janie. And I just pray for her. She's a mighty force. She's a prayer warrior. She has a beautiful prayer room in her house. And I pray protection over her right now in Jesus' name. I don't know why you brought her to my mind, but you did for a reason. So I intercede for my sister, and I love her. And I pray you'd protect her, her husband, her daughter and son-in-law, Father, and their family in Jesus' name. You see how when Holy Spirit begins to prompt you, that you just begin to intercede, and you begin to just pray over them, protection over them, because Holy Spirit wants us to be attuned to him so we can intercede and pray for others, right? So our prayer time together was a little different today. It was teaching you about where your protection comes from, and it comes from the armor of God. So I want to encourage you to go back and read Ephesians 6. Make sure you're putting on the four elements of your warfare, and then picking up the two, and that you're understanding how to walk in that. And you guys, God's got great things in store for us. I want to encourage you. Tomorrow is going to be a fun day. Tomorrow is Story Club Saturday. And I want to encourage you to join me. It's going to be a lot of fun at noon. And we're going to walk through how we're processing COVID-19. And I guarantee you, you're going to want to write some of these emotions and thoughts down. You're going to want to, one day you'll forget a lot of this, but you'll be able to go back and journaling, I'm going to share with you tomorrow. Actually, journaling is a very therapeutic process, and it really helps you get through some of the struggles and difficulties that you're going through right now. So we're going to talk about that tomorrow. I think that was all I had for you guys. Anything you want to share with me? I just want to scroll through right here. Anything you guys have? Valerie, hi. Revival for our minds. Amen. Ephesians 6. Amen. Leanne, amen. Sickness and disease is not our portion. Amen, amen. Toby, my friend, I love you. Remind us that we're here for you. I love you, Toby, and everything you're doing with Grandma's House. Thank you. So many. I just want to make sure I say hi to a lot of you guys. And Cynthia, good to see you, my love. And you guys, it's really important to share this. You can actually just click share it if you feel comfortable with your Facebook followers, your Instagram followers, and you know, they'll watch as much as they want, but God could use this. Maybe they've never heard about the power of the weapons of our warfare in Ephesians 6. So make sure that you're sharing this. And I love you guys so much. I pray you have a great, great weekend. I look forward to seeing you tomorrow, Saturday. Yeah, give me some hearts. That makes me, oh, I love you guys. I love you. I love you. And also, guys, just the feed in and out from one another to encourage one another. We're sisters together on this feed. Also, remember Sunday, if you can drop by some non-perishable foods, canned foods, things like that. We'll be collecting food from 9 till noon right here at Influence Church. I'm looking at the whole pantry set up here. The food lines, guys, right now the unemployment is the highest it's been in our country in a long, long time. So we want to make sure that we're meeting the needs of others. So if you could pick up some items or check your pantry, drive by. It's just kind of good to be close in the house, and you get to drive by the church, and there'll be people that'll actually take those items from you. And I just had an idea I'm thinking that might be kind of fun for us to do. I'm going to share with you next week that we might be able to kind of come in community and still say, stay 6 feet apart. I'll share that with you next week. But I love you guys so much. I look forward to seeing you tomorrow for Story Club Saturday. Make it a great day. Get out, get some exercise. Tell somebody you love them. Read Ephesians 6 and have a great day. Love you guys. God bless.